offering this drink and that gift should not be permitted in the house of worship, either before or after the service. Ardent, active piety should characterize the worshipers. If some have to wait a few minutes before the meeting begins, let them maintain the true spirit of devotion by silent meditation, keeping the heart public to God in prayer, that the service may yield a special benefit to their own hearts and lead to the conviction and the conversion of other souls. They should remember that heavenly messengers are in the house. We all lose much sweet communion with God by our restlessness, by not encouraging moments of reflection and prayer. Elevate the standard of Christianity in the minds of your children. Help them to weave Jesus in their experience. Teach them to have the highest reverence for the house of God, and to understand that when they enter the Lord's house, it should be with hearts that are softened and subdued by such thoughts as these. God is here. This is His house. I must have pure thoughts and holiest motives. This is the place where God meets with me and blesses His people. Parents should not only teach, but command their children to enter the sanctuary with sobriety and reverence. Practice reverence until it becomes a part of yourself. That kind of struck home with me and my family when we read that in our worship. Because I know I'm guilty of just not being with holy thoughts and that just casual things when I come into the house of God. We have to always remember when people met God, it was a humbling experience, wasn't it? You know, people didn't go, hey God, how are you doing? No. They bowed down. Because they knew, oh, woe is me, a sinner. Man, what ugly lips. So, you know, I hope this kind of maybe puts your mind to reflection. It has mine in my family. We're going to try and practice some of the things that have been taught in this lesson of reverence in the house of God. Because, well, we have to remember, we come here to meet God, and we meet with God and fellow believers, and God is a lot loftier and holier than we'll ever be. And I hope and pray that we will humble our souls and we will come into His house of worship with a mindset that we desire to be in the presence of God, in the holiness of His place. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, I thank You again for bringing this lesson to us from Your Spirit of prophecy. I hope and pray that the hearts and minds that heard this will truly take it to heart. I know how it touched my heart, and I pray it will touch each and every one's heart here today, that we will look at ourselves in a different aspect when we enter Your sanctuary, that we will have true reverence for You in this place, that You have provided for us to come every Sabbath. I pray that we'll look at it in a different way. This place is a holy place, and that if we need to, let's humble ourselves and do those things accordingly that will please You and not ourselves. I pray that You be with everyone in leading out today in service, and that each and every one of us will be humbly attentive
they are raising a dollar a week for evangelism. And it's kind of a way of getting the students involved and understanding the need of saving for a fundraiser for God's work. And I just want to let everybody know that if you'd like to help out the students, maybe exceed their goal, I'm sure that Helen would be happy to take your donations and add to our total as much as the school. So keep that in your thoughts. Secondly, we have a PBS fundraiser coming on April 13th. Prior to that, a very important date is Clean Day, April 6th. So we have found a couple, in springtime is the time to get the place cleaned back up again, but we have a special meeting coming for the accreditation of Westwood School on the 17th. So many hands make light work. So let's plug that into your calendar that we can get to God's house and our school looking clean and shiny after a long, hard winter. We have a second reading for John Yankee. Thank you. Tim Cardwell's dad is diagnosed with cancer this week. So let's keep her in family prayers as he's battling that and going through a treatment at this time. And our eyes will move.
He draws airplanes. looks at airplanes, he dreams about airplanes. And actually, as an adult, his job involves airplanes. He actually works on a flight simulation, which is pretty cool, huh? Well, the story today is about a man who also loved planes. Now, he was a very wealthy man, and he actually owned airplane manufacturing facilities as well as entire airlines. So when he had children, he had a couple of boys. What do you think he named them? He named them after airplanes. That's right. His first son was named Douglas, named after McDonnell Douglas. And his second boy was named Falcon, also after an airplane. Now, some of you are critics. You probably know what my story is about already. I really like this story about Douglas when he was a little boy. He was 4 years old. Is anyone here 4 years old? No? You are. I'm sure you guys were 4 years. So he was 4 years old, and his father owned a shoe polishing machine. Now, have you ever seen a shoe polishing machine? Sometimes you see them in hotels, and like in the lobbies, or in the airport, or in men's rooms, in fancy places. And it's like a motor in the middle. It's got this really neat, soft brush on one side. Usually it's black. And on the other side, it's usually brown or red. Well, Douglas's father was a very wealthy man, and so he was an executive, and he used to wear shiny shoes. Now, like Mr. Davis, Mr. Davis here is a shoe shine expert. You'll always notice his shoes, very shiny. And so, Douglas's father, every morning before he went into work, would hit the button and turn on the shoe shine machine, and he would hold his shoes under there, and he would put a real nice shine on. And Douglas just loved this machine. So one Sunday morning, he woke up really early before everyone else got up. And he went out. He couldn't go back to sleep. So now he was going to go out into the rest of the house, out of his bedroom, and he was going to play. So what do you think he decided to play with? The shoe shine machine. That's right. He loved that thing. So he was over there hitting the button and watching the wheels spin, and he hit it and stopped. Soon he got a bright idea. I know what I'll do. I'll surprise David. I'll do something nice. I'll shine and polish his shoes for him. Is that a good idea?
No.
You know how the story ends. But you know what? I think it was a good idea because he wanted to do something nice and he wanted to be helpful. But maybe it was something that he should ask for his father to help him with, right? So he snuck into his parents' bedroom, got his dad's shoes out, took them out in the hallway. Now I know what I need. I need shoe polish. Well, the only shoe polish he knew of, they kept in the boys' room under the sink, and it was a liquid shoe polish. It wasn't the hard paste kind that he usually uses in the machine. So he went over to the wheel, he had the shoes there already, and he wanted them really shiny, so he put a lot of that shoe polish. He squirted it all over the wheel. And then he hit the button. What do you think happened? There was a real polishing going on. That polish went up the wall and on the ceiling and the wall behind him. It went everywhere but on the shoes. And so then he thought, maybe this wasn't such a good idea after all. So he put the lid on the polish and put it away, took the shoes, put them back in his dad's closet, and went and got back in bed. Then we know what would happen. Right? So a little while later, he kind of heard his dad get up, kind of rustle around, out in the hallway. Then he came and opened their bedroom door, and he looked in, and he instantly said, Dougie, called his boy Douglas, Dougie, what Doug do? He tried to play like he was asleep and didn't hear, and maybe he'd go away. No, Dougie, opens his eyes, says, come out here, please. So he walks out to the scene of the crime, shoe polish all over the walls, and his dad asks him, Dougie, do you know what happened here? So his dad asked him again, Dougie, do you know what happened here? No, no. Third time, his father asked him, now, Doug, please tell me, do you know what happened here? You know what? Doug lied and said, no, I don't know. So about that time, his dad decided to pick him up, warm him up in the morning, backside. while he was warming him up, he was saying, "No, no, yeah, yeah, I did it, I did it." And as his father sat him down, as he was giving him a spanking, he said, "I want you to know something. I'm not spanking you because you made a mistake with shoe polish. I understand that. I'm giving you a punishment because you lied to me. Don't ever lie to me. If you make mistakes, it's okay, but don't lie to me." And so Doug learned from that lesson that he should never tell a lie. Now, something else he didn't realize when he did that shoe polishing was his dad had a very, very expensive painting on the wall of a Spanish soldier. And it got a good coat of shoe polish right there in the middle of it when he turned the machine on. So, like Doug's father, our Heavenly Father knows that we're going to make mistakes. Any of you ever make mistakes? I know I do. But you know what? Jesus is ready to forgive. And even though he already knows we did it, if we would just come to him and tell him that we made a mistake, he is ready and willing to forgive us. And so I look at the image of Jesus and the little story that goes, "When I look at myself, I think, how can I be saved? But when I look at Jesus, I think, how can I be lost?" So I want you to remember that story this morning, that we can always trust Jesus and that we should always tell the truth. Okay? Good listeners. Thank you so much. And then ask your parents if they know who the little boy Doug is.
There were brothers, we bring back a portion to you.
waiting for us to open the door. Because Jesus will force himself into our lives, he asks us to let him in. And this is what we're talking about today. And in Jesus' name.
Thank you.
Anyway, Mr. Bachelor was an interesting person. One of the few things I remember that he said was that he had flown across the Atlantic in a DC-3, from Los Angeles to Hawaii, Honolulu, in a DC-3, and he said he'd never do it again. So I think that was a pretty slow trip. But anyway, he had a nice airline, and things were like to go over there. Like I said, that's my story, but there's a lot of other stories there.
You know, the part of the story that I forgot, Mark, was Doug, when he went back to his room after his punishment, was perplexed as to how his dad knew that he was blind.
Yeah.
And when he went into the bathroom, he stepped up on his foot, and you could see black shoe polish all over his face.
That's a good story. And then he went away. He seemed like a regular guy when you meet him. But I guess we all have those growing up stories, you know? Because I've done stuff like that. Maybe not the super polished thing, but I've done a lot of that, you know? But that's good. Thank you for that story. And Chantal, thank you for that music, too. It's very inspirational. Today's title was What We Believe About Creation. And it sort of comes from this book. The pastor wants all of us elders to be talking about the beliefs of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And so we have this little book printed by the General Conference, I believe it is. And it has many topics, and today's is the creation. So that was my topic today. So in case you were wondering why creation, that's where it came from. But, you know, we start out with these are one of the fundamental beliefs of being an Adventist. And, of course, what I always say, and I tell all my Bible students when I start Bible studies, is that being an Adventist is really nothing more than following the Bible. There's nothing in the Bible that we don't believe in. That's why we keep the Sabbath. That's why we don't eat certain things. That's why we do many things that we do. And it's all because of what's in the Bible. Out there is many churches that say they're Bible-believing churches, but in the end, that turns out to be not the whole truth. But with creation, it starts at the very beginning, is the foundation of why we're all here today. God created us in His image. And to remember that God created something from nothing. There was nothing. He doesn't depend on pre-existing matter or anything. He can create it just by his speech. And you and I, when we build things, you know, we depend on, you know, a sheet of metal or lumber or something so we can build a house or whatever we're doing. But for God, he can just speak it and it happens. So we find out then that there's something more to God's creation than what we do. And so, it's the power of a creator. George Bernard Shaw once said, "You see things and you say, why? But I dream things that never were, and I say, why not?" And this is the essence of what God our Father has done with the creation of you and I. Because God must have asked that question, why not? Why not make creatures, much like himself, able to plan, to be independent, to love, and to be loved? To be able to reason. And the one thing, most of all, was to live forever. That was his plan for us. There's so many things to look around at his creation. It's full of so many things that require thought. You look at science, and it points to so many things. You know, one of the interesting things is that as scientists keep looking, there's these traces of the ability to time travel. To be able to go to the future or to be able to travel back and forth. We know God already has this power. But science is on the heels of how this is done. Or you look at nature on a bright sunny day and you watch a seagull if you're down at the beach and how they soar above your head. Or here in Missouri you watch the vultures in the summer and they start out right above your head and in just a few minutes they just fade into a little speck. And you ask yourself, what makes them fly, you know, if you're curious. Or human science, you know, what is life? What makes up life? There's physiology, there's psychology. You know, psychology can tell you, interestingly enough, psychology can tell us a lot of things of certain
it was a time for him to commune with his creation. And in person, if you remember Adam and Eve, he visited God. God visited Adam and Eve in the garden in the cool of the evening. And with that, just by being quiet, they could listen to the wisdom of the ages. He could tell them all the mysteries of the universe, how the planets got there, how they work. But after the fall, we still can have that personal relationship with him. But now it's done by thinking. By closing our eyes, we can bring God near to us in just a fraction of seconds. And we can learn why we're here and from what is our purpose in moving. So that's why the Sabbath is such a nice time. And of course, it's all about just cutting down our activity, closing our eyes, meditating on his words and word of God, contemplating the cross, forgetting the pain of the week, imagining what a new earth restored would be like, and taking the Sabbath to imagine a place where love is supreme, and you can roam the universe and never find anger or hatred or selfishness anywhere. Because that's what it will be like to be in this new earth that God promises for us. We won't have to worry about, you know, coming to a place and finding people that don't like you or that feel like you're not worth anything. But God really is going to have places like that for us. So when you watch TV, or you go to a ball game, or any other form of entertainment on the Sabbath, you lose that rest that was intended to be a blessing for you. Does losing that peace make you want to keep the Sabbath better and as God had intended? To feel the peace that transcends this world? You know, I do, because I've had times in my life where I've kept the Sabbath really well, and it really lingers with you for the rest of the week if you do that. And so I just encourage everyone to look at your activities that you do on the Sabbath, and God will tell you as you become closer to him, you will do the right things that you're supposed to do. And now at the close of Earth's history, it is the Adventist Church that we must remind the world to return to the true worship of God. And what two things are in the message? Worship God as the Creator and keep the Sabbath. So turn with me, if you will, to Revelation 14, 6 and 7. And we will see the answer there. And it doesn't seem so obvious when you read it. Because that's the way things are in Bible study. Sometimes it's just a word or there's something there. But it means a lot more sometimes. And so I'm here to help you see this. And it says this: "And I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation and kindred and tongue and people, saying with a loud voice, Fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come, and worship him that made heaven and earth and the sea and the fountains of water." So within that reference, we see the word worship within that verse 7. That word worship is calling our world back to the original worship of the Creator. And part of the original worship is the Sabbath. Again, the Sabbath and creation are inseparable. And they go together. There's no way to separate them. Because every time you talk about creation, you also remember the Sabbath. And when you talk about the Sabbath, you remember that the world was created in 6 days before the Sabbath. So, we are here as a church. That's why our very existence of this church is here, to remind the last day message that not only is Christ coming to change things again, to restore us, the restoration. God wants to restore his image in us. So, when we see that word worship encompassed into that one world, that one word is the calling of the world back to the true worship and the worship of the Sabbath. And remember, when the word God is used, it's talking about Jesus Christ. He is God. And we see the books of Genesis and the Revelation. We don't realize they are just like bookends. In the beginning was creation and the Sabbath, and in its end was creation and the Sabbath. And nothing was added in between or taken away. God's word is the same. And it's so simple. And in Genesis 1:31, it says that God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. So, in Genesis, we see that the world was perfect when it came from the Creator's hand. But something happened, and that was what God had never intended, and that was a fall from the grace that we had had with God. And we made a heartbreak with God because we wanted, in the end, we wanted to lose the world. And that was the whole point of the story of the lost coin. You know, the lost coin in the Bible. The lady lost her coin, and it was in the dust and in the darkness. And it was the lady that went and looked for it. She swept it clean, and when she found it, she was rejoicing. And it's the same thing that God did. He reached out. The coin didn't care that it was in the dirt. Just like you and I, we don't care when we're lost. We just keep going. But when God reached out like he did, then we realized there's a better place for us. There's a better way to live than we're living in the darkness and in the dirt. Then we believe in a creator that created the world in 6 literal days. And it didn't take eons, as many churches and even atheists believe took this great amount of time to come together. And yet our Bible tells us that it only took 6 days. And again, it was perfect when it came from the Creator's hand. And note this parallel. It says, you know, remember Exodus 20, verse 8, where it says, you know, in 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work. And if you look in that, it was parallel with the very beginning in Genesis, where it said that in the 6th day God finished his work, and he called him, he's blessed. So we see again this 6th day. So now we know we have a guideline. We have a definite way of living. We work 6 days and we rest 7. It's very plain. God has given us a guide or a workbook or however you want to look at it. He's given us a way that we can live. And it's a direction. It's plain as a direction. To work 6 days and to rest on the 7th. That's even better than the world. Because if the world works 7 days a week usually and non-stop all the time, it doesn't matter what job it is. But when we turn with me to Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1 and 2. I'm going to look at something here. This is another one of the Adventist beliefs, and it's stated here in Hebrews 1, 1 and 2. And it says this: God, who at sundry times and in diverse manners spake in times past unto our fathers by the prophets, has in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he has appointed heir of all things, and by whom he made the worlds. So we see then that we can say that one of our beliefs that God created the world, that's Jesus again. And in John, if you remember in the beginning of John, verse 1 to 3, you turn with me to there too. Which is the book of John. And it says this: in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God, and all things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. And so we see again, Jesus is called the Word. He embodies. So that's why he says, you know, I am the Word, the truth, and the life. Jesus is the physical embodiment of everything that he represents. And he was called the Word. And so we can have a surety that what he says is true. And we see So we see then that that we can believe that God the Father created all things through His Son Jesus. That's another one of the beliefs. Jesus did everything in accordance to His Father's will. His Father, when Jesus created the world, He was doing His Father's will. So don't forget that Jesus, and that we can do this too, when we do it. When we want to invite the Lord into our lives, we will do God's will at that point. And Jesus ever lived to do His Father's will. And He had the very words to say, and He brought everything into existence except us by this word. He created, He took the time to form us with the clay and breathe into our lips breath of life. So that's why when God speaks something, He cannot lie, for everything that He says happens. So that's why He's very careful with His words, and I think that's why He asks Christians as well, if we're going to be like Him, to watch what we say. For with God, He can turn nothing into something. But for us, we may not be able to make things appear what we say, but the things that we do say can create a lot of heartache, or they can create a lot of anger. And we can also choose to create love and happiness with our lives as well. It's our choice, and God wants us to do the last one. Creating love and happiness with our lives rather than anger. One of the other things we believe is that humans have a purpose, and that's first to honor God, our Creator, and to love each other and be caretakers of this world that He's given us. And one of the verses Jesus quoted when He became human was out of Deuteronomy 6, verse 5. You'll turn with me there and look at that verse. And you'll recognize it right away. And Jesus quoted this all the time. Or it's quoted many times in the scriptures. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5. And it starts out like this. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy might. So we see then that one of our purposes is to love God. And as Adventists, that's certainly one of the things we believe in. So we were created to love the Lord. And it was something that is our duty today. And if you turn with me to Matthew 12:37, you'll also see that Jesus used the same word, but He added something to it. And that's why it becomes a totally whole package of loving the Lord. Because once you love the Lord, then we can love each other. And it does that with human relations and marriage. And then the marriage is it's almost imperative that you have this, you have the Lord, that you love the Lord first, and then you can love each other better. In Matthew 12:37, it says this. For by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned. And so Jesus had said that. So by our words, so words have a very important meaning. And so we see them. But one of the other things that I wanted to bring out with this verse as well is where Jesus said that thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy might. And thy neighbor as thyself. So Jesus added that part, and when He did, it created this whole package of love to God. Because it's not just loving God and I can hate everyone else that I don't like. But it was a package of loving the Lord and then loving each other. And that's the order And that's why this very self-centered view mentioned use drugs and get trapped into many of the addictions today, or remark yourself with a tattoo because, hey, it's my mom. But the scripture gives us wisdom concerning the modern day view of ourselves. Turn with me to 1 Corinthians 6:19. So here in the Bible we see the words that we do not own our own body. We are caretakers of our body in a sense. So when we do that, your body is the Lord's, and even further, it's a temple, a sacred place. And it's a temple because God wants to live and speak with you and be part of your life. So doesn't that give you a whole different perspective of yourself, and that God has given you this body, and in addition, He gives you the self-worth that you should have because He's dwelling with you? As Adventists, we call it great heritage. Creation is just one of many topics that set you and I apart. Doesn't this one make you commit yourself to God and ask Him to fulfill the special purpose He has in mind for you? So He is not only the creator of the whole universe, but He had created it with you in mind. And not for the application of what creation should mean to us in our everyday life, besides the fact that we are here. You know, just the fact that we are here, creation should mean something to us. But the first thing we could think about is, are there any problems that are too big for the creator of the universe to solve? Well, that seems like an obvious answer. I would say no. But what about times when we don't receive an answer right away and things just keep lingering and going on and on? It seems like, you don't know how long it lasts like that. But look to this Bible for an answer. And one of them is the story of Abraham. He had waited 100 years to receive the promise. Or the story of Job. And even though we're not told how long Job waited, he was homeless at those times, and so we don't know how long that happened, but it must have been long enough to make him wonder if things were ever going to get better. Because that's how God does that, obviously, in my life. I get an answer, but sometimes it's not when I wanted it, and it's certainly not as fast as I wanted it. But the Bible has full of examples of that same thing. And since the Sabbath is part of creation, and should always remind us of God's great power, ask what activities are acceptable before God to do on the Sabbath. The life of Christ reveals to us what kind of day it should be. Jesus went to the synagogues, and you and I are here today, so that's one thing we've done. He healed, he visited, and he loved people that whole day. He loved people every day, so that wasn't something that he did just on the Sabbath. But these are the activities, and these are just principles, so from these we can gain the knowledge of what we should do. But when we go to ball games, or you turn on the TV and you watch television for the whole rest of the day, that's really not the right way to keep the Sabbath. You're losing tremendously when you do that. So then knowing that you have been purposely placed here, and that God has a place for you, where you're at right now, does this want to make you live differently? Well, look at the story of Joseph. He was sold into slavery. He went to prison. And then, in the end, he was promoted to be where God wanted him to be. And then in the end, if you turn with me to Genesis 4, 45, verse 8, Joseph could say this about his life. And it's good that we can say the same thing about all the ins and outs of our lives, that we could end up looking back and saying what Joseph said to his brothers. And Genesis 45, verse 8, it says, "So now it was not you that sent me here, but God, and He has made me a father. is that God took the most righteous man he could find and wiped out the rest of the world. And he started the world again with the most righteous man. So think in our lives, like, let's say he wiped out the world now, he made a new race out of Doug Bassler or the president of the conference. And but you know what happened? Sin came back again. And this story shows us that unless God does something radical to us on the inside, sin will always be there. And that's why this creation should give us hope that he has the power to create in us a new heart and a new mind. And so we have that to look forward to. So we can start our new song here. That's it. Let's see. Number 88, I sing the mighty power of God. Jesus someday when he comes to get us. And I ask all